What do you think of when you think about grief? Is it the hole in your heart that someone left behind? The way the room fills with water when you hear news of their passing? Or an inky blackness that washes over your life soon after? Whatever it is, it probably doesn't resemble vibrant watercolor paintings, but that's the visual style that the developers at Nomada chose to represent the grieving process. And that choice, with the juxtaposition it makes between some of the darkest times in our lives and such beautiful artwork, show us some of the beauty to be found in grieving. The way Gris engages with the grieving process reframes the way we usually see grief represented in popular culture. The structure of the game is grounded in Kubler-Ross's five-stage model of grief, but unlike most media that engage with this model, Gris is thematically focused on healing from the trauma of loss rather than the experience of that trauma. The beginning of the game takes place in a gray wasteland, and when you first take control of the woman, she walks slowly for a while before finally collapsing for a few moments. The desolate environment and lack of color convey a numbness that often accompanies shock. In their book, On Grief and Grieving, Elizabeth Kubler-Ross and David Kessler write,
"When we are in denial, we may respond at first by being paralyzed with shock or blanketed with numbness. The denial is still not denial of the actual death, even though someone may be saying, 'I can't believe he's dead.' The person is actually saying that at first, because it is too much for his or her psyche."
Likewise, the game doesn't present this stage as overlooking that trauma has happened. It opens, after all, with the woman's world literally crumbling underneath her. Rather than trying to turn away completely, her emotions get blocked out enough that she isn't overwhelmed by all the feelings that accompany grief at once, but in a way that prepares her to face them head-on as she's ready to do so.
Denial helps us to pace our feelings of grief. There is a grace in denial. It is nature's way of letting in only as much as we can handle.
The gray serves as a canvas upon which to paint her emotional colors as she moves forward and processes them, just as denial gives us an emotional canvas upon which the preceding stages are painted.
As you accept the reality of the loss and start to ask yourself questions, you are unknowingly beginning the healing process. You are becoming stronger, and the denial is beginning to fade. But as you proceed, all the feelings you were denying begin to surface.
The first time we come across a piece of the statue after it's crumbled, the woman writhes in pain and bright splotches of red fill the screen. Denial has served its purpose. Her feelings have begun to surface and she's prepared to face them.
This stage presents itself in many ways. Anger at your loved one that he didn't take better care of himself, or anger that you didn't take better care of him. Anger does not have to be logical or valid. You may be angry that you didn't see this coming, and when you did, nothing could stop it. You may be angry with the doctors for not being able to save someone so dear to you. You may be angry that bad things could happen to someone who meant so much to you.
The central mechanic of this level is one of stubbornness, which we can read to be how her anger presents itself. The woman forms her cloak into the shape of a brick and slams herself into the ground to prevent the heavy winds from blowing her away, as though to stamp a foot down and exclaim, "I will not be thrown around by the turmoil in my life."
Anger is strength, and it can be an anchor, giving temporary structure to the nothingness of loss. At first, grief feels like being lost at sea, no connection to anything. The anger becomes a bridge over the open sea, a connection from you to them. It is something to hold on to, and a connection made from the strength of anger feels better than nothing.
By framing the levels mechanic as they did, it highlights the usefulness of anger as a coping mechanism to establish power and agency at times when we've lost stability. It also gives us more of a feminine interpretation of some of the five stages. The stubbornness that comes through is counter to the aggressive expression of anger that dominates our cultural perception, since that's what we associate with masculinity. That interpretation is most clear in the green level, much of which revolves around helping a little forest creature find its way home. It's a motherly expression of bargaining, one of nurturing, shifting attention from herself onto someone else, rather than a self-centered one. What can I give to get what I want?
Bargaining can help our mind move from one state of loss to another. It can be a way station that gives our psyche the time it may need to adjust. Bargaining may fill the gaps that our strong emotions generally dominate, which often keep suffering at a distance. It allows us to believe that we can restore order to the chaos that has taken over.
Bargaining helps us externalize our grieving and turn our attention outside ourselves and our emotions. This level demonstrates that externalization by representing bargaining in terms of mutual aid and cooperation. After all, sometimes the best way to work through our own problems is to help someone else. The layout of the caverns play a big role in how we read the blue stage. Swimming down and exploring the caves is symbolic of exploring the depths of depression.
As tough as it is, depression can be dealt with in a paradoxical way. See it as a visitor, perhaps an unwelcome one, but one who is visiting whether you like it or not. Make a place for your guest. Invite your depression to pull up a chair with you in front of the fire and sit with it without looking for a way to escape. Allow the sadness and emptiness to cleanse you and help you explore your loss in its entirety. When you allow yourself to experience depression, it will leave as soon as it has served its purpose in your loss. As you grow stronger, it may return from time to time, but that is how grief works.
Rather than trying to avoid it, to climb out from the depths of the caves she finds herself in, she swims down through the darkness to see what's hiding down there for her to find. And what we find is a place worth exploring. It may be dark, but it isn't scary.
As difficult as it is to endure, depression has elements that can be helpful in grief. It slows us down and allows us to take real stock of the loss. It makes us rebuild ourselves from the ground up. It clears the deck for growth. It takes us to a deeper place in our soul that we would not normally explore.
This level is more slow-moving than the others in general. Swimming through water is slower than walking over land. And once we finally reached the bottom, fully brought that emotion to bear, we can start going up again. In the middle of the caves, we come across a large, glowing turtle that helps us swim deeper into the darkness. The radiant light that emanates from the turtle comes across like a warm friend, giving support in a time of need.
Most people's initial reaction to sad people is to try to cheer them up, to tell them not to look at things so grimly, to look on the bright side of life. A mourner should be allowed to experience his sorrow, and he will be grateful for those who can sit with him without telling him not to be sad.
When we first see it, the turtle doesn't try to swim upward, lifting the woman back to the surface. It moves downward with her, helping her explore more deeply than she's able to on her own. Then later, once she's explored that depth of her depression, it returns to help in a moment of danger as she's being chased by the black eel, this time helping her make a return to the surface. As a friend, it responds to what her needs are whenever they're together, helping her to explore sorrow when she's able and escape despair when she gets overwhelmed. And finally, the lights that appear to guide the way out of her pit of depression also form a staircase for her to continue climbing toward the sky. And it's in this final stage that we see the full range of colors throughout the game filling the canvas. But rather than being a level of triumph, dominated by warm colors, trumpets, and brass instruments playing a fanfare, the level still has an atmosphere of melancholy. The structures that construct the level are a cool, soft blue, with reds and yellows only scattering the scenery enough to provide a gentle warmth. That's because acceptance isn't a stage in which our grieving has finished.
Acceptance is often confused with the notion of being all right or okay with what has happened. This is not the case. We will never like this reality or make it okay. But eventually we accept it. We learn to live with it.
The world, turned upside down, is flipped right side up again at the very end. But even in that moment, it isn't made to feel triumphant. This process has made the world easier to navigate once again, but we continue to carry that loss with us as we continue to do that navigating.
Little by little, we withdraw our energy from the loss and begin to invest it in life. We put the loss into perspective, learning how to remember our loved ones and commemorate the loss. Finding acceptance may be just having more good days than bad.
So too, the woman is able to direct her energy toward being able to sing again. It may even be that singing is a way for her to commemorate her loss, as we saw when she attempted earlier to sing before one of the large statues. Kubler-Ross puts a lot of attention in her writing to point out that while she has outlined and sometimes narrativized these stages in this order, they're neither linear nor discrete. It's a common misinterpretation that people will necessarily experience each stage in a specific way in this prescribed order. But that just isn't true to how we experience grief. In my own experience, for example, I tend to go through depression before anger and bargaining, and I usually pass through anger much more quickly than the other stages. While the levels of the game do follow the stages in a prescriptive sequence with a clear delineation between them, there is some blending between them as new colors don't cleanly enter the picture at the end of a given level. More importantly, though, the color palette is additive. Previous colors don't disappear to be replaced by new ones, and the mechanics aren't one and done. The world builds on itself because trauma and healing aren't linear. They don't follow neat, discretized steps, but when we gain new tools, when we learn new ways of coping, we take them with us and continue to use them in the future. Our past experiences color our world moving forward, in this case literally.
In our worst, we have the power to find some thread of hope. In grief, just like in death, there's a transformation for the living. If you do not take the time to grieve, you cannot find a future in which loss is remembered and honored without pain.
The game uses the five stages to convey its themes of grief, but it's not really about the five stages, the same way its use of color conveys those same themes without being about those colors. While Gris engages more deeply with Kubler-Ross's work than most other media I've seen trying to do the same, limiting a reading to how it fits within that five-stage framework would not just miss the forest for the trees, I think it misses what really makes the game special. It isn't just the rich colors that make the world feel as vibrant as it is. Though most of the game has a lonely feel, the environments are teeming with life. Even in the gray, barren wasteland of the first stage, we see this huge, majestic creature flying across the background. No matter how isolated we might feel while grieving, we're never totally cut off from the world. There are always others around us. Sometimes just the presence of loved ones can be comforting. Even if they don't know what to say or how to help, simply being around those whose company we enjoy can ease a lot of the emotional burdens of grieving. There's a recurring motif of broken statues throughout the game, most notably the giant statues that punctuate the stages, but also an abundance of smaller statues spread across the landscape. One of the ways we cope with loss is by poring over whatever memories we have of the departed, and the statues are symbolic of that remembrance. When we cling to those memories, we try to fill the void they've left in their absence by reminding ourselves of the place they had in our lives. And as we continue that remembrance, we uncover more and more memories that we wouldn't have been quick to recollect without that effort. As the statues appear throughout the game, we see them in varying states of disrepair, in general, being more complete statues as we progress. When we put our focus to recalling whatever memories we can, we also construct a more complete picture, one that recognizes them for the complex human beings that they were, rather than looking past their faults to exalt them in death. We cherish the memories that brought us joy, that exemplify the height of our connection with them. But we can also cherish the complicated memories, the ones that might be harder to face. There are, of course, major exceptions, but we often should cherish those difficult memories as well, because they help us appreciate the depth of the roles they played in our lives, and the space they continue to hold in our hearts. The black goo that narratively functions as an antagonist takes a different shape whenever it appears, because grief takes different shapes when it emerges in our lives. Not only do different people grieve differently, we as individuals experience and express grief differently when we grieve the loss of different people and even at different times in grieving a single person. It's not a coincidence that the first time we encounter the black goo is in a room whose only contents are a collection of broken statues. When we do that remembrance, trying to fill that hole they've left, we shift focus between our memories to different aspects of our relationship with them. And as the shape of our memory changes, the shape of our pain changes with it. So too, when we grieve different people throughout our lives, our grief takes a different shape each time, a shape that fits the relationship we had with them.
Each grief has its own imprint, as distinctive and as unique as the person we lost. The pain of loss is so intense, so heartbreaking, because in loving, we deeply connect with another human being, and grief is the reflection of the connection that has been lost. We think we want to avoid the grief, but really, it is the pain of the loss we want to avoid. Grief is the healing process that ultimately brings us comfort in our pain.
The Room of Statues isn't just the first place we see the goo, it appears to originate from there as well. By tying the two ideas together this way, it's showing us that the way we work through the pain of loss is by facing it, going through it to bring their memory to light. Even though that process can generate more pain as we go through it. Ultimately, the core theme of the game, I think, is that grief itself is beautiful. I mean, how amazing is it that we can care so deeply for one another that when we lose someone from our lives, it causes us that much pain? And by making the choice to represent the grieving process in this way, it's reframed to focus on healing rather than experiencing trauma. That focus on healing shows us the usefulness of different emotional responses and coping, rather than just the way they're expressed. At the end of the game, the woman dispels the black goop that's enveloped her, gives a tear-felt goodbye kiss to the broken statue, and ascends beyond her grief, accepting that loss. While it wraps a nice bow around the ending of the game, it's not really true to the realities of grieving. There is no moment of closure when you can suddenly let go of someone, and no force of will can vanquish that pain.
The reality is that you will grieve forever. You will not get over the loss of a loved one. You will learn to live with it. You will heal, and you will rebuild yourself around the loss that you have suffered. You will be whole again. But you will never be the same. Nor should you be the same. Nor would you want to.
Grief doesn't ever really end. It stays with you. But that isn't necessarily a bad thing. To rid yourself of grief would also rid yourself of the love you felt towards those you've lost. That love and that pain, they're the same thing, and that's something I'd much rather hang on to.